Hey y'all, I'm Courtney Sharea. Welcome to my channel. Today we're doing something a little bit different. This is the very first interview in my new interview series where I'm interviewing healthcare administration and biotechnology professionals to learn more about their careers and their educational pathways. My very first guest is serial biotechnology entrepreneur, Dr. Ryan Fiorini. Hey, Ryan.
Hello.
Thank you so much for joining us today.
Happy to be here.
So, do you want to start off by telling everybody how we met?
I love the story of how we met. So, I had a biotech company that was sold, and the company that we were now working for required me to have an assistant. And I had a temp agency bring in a few people, and you were one of the first. And little known fact, I hired you on the spot, and there were people after you that interviewed, but you already had the job. When we met, I knew that you would fulfill all of the parts that were needed, and I also knew that you could take on a lot more than just being the executive assistant.
Yes, and I am so thankful that you believed in me and hired me on the spot. I was kind of shocked when I left that interview. And you know, you really pushed me to do a lot more than an executive assistant. You taught me a lot. You allowed me to do the budget at Intrexon. You encouraged me to start up an inventory system. And I just am really thankful for all of the inspiration and motivation that you gave me during the time that we worked together. So now that everyone knows how we met, let's talk about you. Tell us about Dr. Ryan Fiorini.
I have always loved science, and I went and got my bachelor's degree in pre-med. I knew I didn't want to be a physician, so I went and did my PhD. About halfway through, I knew that I didn't want to stay in academia. It was just a little too slow. I finished my PhD. I wanted to be in business, and so I found the perfect balance, which was working for the tech transfer office, or the intellectual property, the patent office for a university. And being able to do that, I get to see science, I get to mesh it with business. So I ended up also going after that, doing my MBA mm-hmm. and my master's in health administration. I was one of the first students to do both of those. And those gave me a really good background of what you need in order to take a technology and move it from academia to the commercial the commercial realm.
So you have a very unique skill set where you have this very strong business acumen, but you also understand science. Can you tell me a little bit about how that unique blend of both business and science helps drive you in your biotechnology startups?
You know, I have a good science background, obviously, with my PhD. I've always loved science, but I think a lot of that can also be learned. It helps because I can analyze technologies. You know, my job normally in the companies that I start is chief technology officer or something, chief science officer, something in that aspect. And I'm really there to be able to tie the two together. So for example, in my company right now, my job is to get the medical device to a point where it can then be handed off to the people that know what they're doing for sales and for running the clinical trials. And so I think it's really important in business to know what you're good at and what you're not good at and being able to pass those off. And so I'm good at taking something from something that's very immature, something that's very academia-based, and being able to move it to science, or move it to commercial. But I don't think you have to have that science background.
So you spoke about being a chief technology officer, and in your current biotechnology startup, Blink CNS, you are the CTO. So tell us what a day in the life as the CTO of a biotechnology company looks like.
So I have a team of software engineers, of mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, and I'm not an engineer. My PhD was immunology and microbiology. I've always loved taking things apart. I've never been great at putting things back together. Always have extra parts when I'm done. But I've learned to work with those engineers. So that's really my job, is to almost act as a translator between the engineers and the clinical trial coordinators and the marketing team and the investor relations team. So I'm almost the translator. So I had to learn enough, and I think that's an example of I have no engineering training, but I had to learn enough of it to be able to translate. And so I think that's normally what my day consists of, is talking to the engineers, making sure that our product is moving forward. Because we took something that a lot of people thought was impossible to move forward, we actually had engineering firms tell us what we were asking for was impossible. And it was really exciting to be able to work through that and get something that we're able to put out there and help people with. And so my job on a normal day is, there might be a problem with something, how are we gonna fix it? If there's not a problem, what areas are we gonna make better? Also then working with our clinical trial people. They may come in and say, hey, this clinical trial needs the device to do X, and right now it doesn't do that. How can we do that? And then I get with our engineering team, we figure out a way around it. Sometimes it literally consists of drilling holes and putting tubes and 3D printing pieces. And so I really act as that coordinator from day to day.
You've mentioned twice that you have experience in certain aspects. However, there is so much more that you're capable of learning and doing, and you don't have to know everything walking into certain roles. And so I think that's important for people to know, especially people who want to get into biotech or into healthcare administration. A lot of them feel so afraid to even apply to jobs because they're like, well, I don't have this experience, and so I'll never get the opportunity to show that I'm even capable. So I like that you've dropped some gems on us and let us know that, hey, like, you don't have to know everything, but you have to be open and receptive to learning.
Absolutely. So the first person I hired for Blink CNS, at the time, I was looking for someone who had a background of neurology and understand the brain, and I wasn't able to find that person. And then I found someone who said they would take the job, and she had a background of understanding small business and understanding how small businesses grow, and she had years of experience there, but didn't have any science background. She came to me and she said, well, I would love this job, but I have absolutely no science background. I said, I can teach you the neurology. What I can't teach is what I said of, I can't teach that you can speak to people. I can't teach that you can learn quickly. And she is now, she has gone from our first employee, she is now our chief operating officer of the company, and is doing an awesome job at it. And she came in with absolutely zero medical background. She had one biology class in college, and otherwise she was a communications major.
That is amazing. Y'all hear that? Like, don't allow your lack of education or lack of experience to stop you from applying to jobs, okay? Because if you're able to learn, and if you have the soft skills that Ryan mentioned, if you're able to learn, if you have great ethics, and you're just, what would you say? Like, if you're just, what type of person would you say?
Yeah, I think if you're driven. If you're driven to learn.
Yeah, don't stop yourself from applying, because you never know, you never know.
You know, I think this also brings me to the time that after we left the biotech company, my wife's medical practice had not been performing the way it should. And the biggest problem was their administrator was not doing her job. And went to my wife, who also knew you, and we pushed you into taking that job and leading a surgical medical practice. And I remember you saying, Ryan, I've never done this. I don't know about billing. And I told you the exact same thing I told you day one, and I told our COO, I said, you can learn that part. The hard part is knowing that you're gonna be ethical and you're gonna make sure that the money is in the right place and you're gonna make sure that the patients are taken care of. That's something that I think is very difficult to teach. Mm-hmm. And you did that and turned a practice around from one that was losing money to one that was making money. Yeah. And you did it quickly. And I know you had doubts. We had no doubts. And I think that's the part that being in biotech is very risky. It's a risky investment. The upside of that is it can be a very good investment. The upsides are higher, but the risks are higher.
You're dropping gems, Ryan. Dr. Fiorini. So you're currently working on the iStat device. Tell us a little bit more about iStat.
So I started the company 4 years ago, a little over 4 years ago. We started with an idea that if you use the blink reflex, a reflex that a little bit of air gets puffed on your eyelashes, you will blink. And it's a very simple biological and anatomy type system, physiological system that a nerve goes to your brainstem, it comes right back and tells you to blink to keep things from getting in your eyes. And so we thought, well, maybe we can tie other diseases to that. So the first we did was concussion, traumatic brain injury. So a very small amount of anatomy. The brain is essentially floating inside of the skull. And when the person is moving at high speeds and stops suddenly, physics says the brain will keep moving. And it smashes into the inside of the skull. And then it kind of bounces back. So it's like two wrecking balls smashing into the brain, causing what we call a concussion. And so we made this device that sits on a tripod and put it up to your eyes and puffs a little bit of air on the corner of your eyes, causes you to blink. There's some high-speed cameras watching and taking thousands of pictures over 20 seconds and looking at different points. And over those 20 or 30 seconds, our clinical trials are looking at things like not only concussion anymore, but also Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's, migraines, ADHD, dry eye. And these are all things that we're doing trials on with the device to see if we can diagnose them or aid in the diagnosis of any of those diseases. So really what most of our company is doing right now are clinical trials in all those different areas. So we started out as Blink TBI, and we have since moved to Blink CNS, the CNS being central nervous system. And so now we're all Blink CNS, and we're moving towards getting a smaller device. So right now it sits on a tripod. We're working on a device that'll be out later this year that looks like a virtual reality headset, weighs less than 2 pounds. You slip it on your head, you could even, a doctor could send it home with somebody, and it could potentially watch their progression of Alzheimer's or dementia. Potentially, we wanna see if it could, if someone could know if they're gonna have a migraine before it actually happens, and they could then treat it. ADHD, it could maybe go in doctor's offices and tell if somebody has ADHD and if they need to be treated with it. Those are all the areas we're looking at. And so it makes for busy days. We've got a lot of clinical trials. That's most of our staff deals with managing those clinical trials. They're all around the world. We have some in Italy, all around the United States. We've got about 30 units right now that are out there collecting data for us on a daily basis.
That is extremely interesting. What other industries can benefit from the use of the iStat?
So right now, it's all medical. One area that we are looking at is using it almost as a breathalyzer for cannabis. So marijuana being legalized in a lot of states and stays in your system so long that a blood test really doesn't tell you anything. And so what happens is someone could get in California, for example, someone get pulled over and they may have smoked marijuana 24 hours before and their blood test will show that they have it in there. So it's left to the police officer, you know, someone who is you know, minimally trained to do that. It's not fair to the police officer. It's not fair to the person who's getting the test. And so a study we're doing right now is using our device. Person gets in a driving simulator. We test them ahead of time. They drive. They then smoke a certain amount of marijuana. We put them back in the driving simulator, test them again, and we're able to hopefully be able to put these ideally in all police cars. And so now every police car in California has one, or in Colorado, any state that legalizes marijuana. And instead of this being on the police officer to have to take a pen and say, what, you know, follow my pen, instead this device goes up and in 20 seconds can say, this person is not able to drive, or this person is fine to drive. So that's kind of out of the, you know, the medical world. But pretty much everything, because the device looks at the brainstem, everything is pretty much tied to the central nervous system.
Wow, that's amazing. And I'm sure you don't have many issues getting trial participants for the cannabis study.
Yeah, we have a number of schools in the states that it's legalized. And they normally don't have a problem finding people to do that. Yeah.
Okay, so tell me, where do you see the iStat in the next 5 years, and ultimately how will it help people?
So our plan forward is in the next 6 months we'll get the device approved by the FDA as the indication will be to test a person's blink reflex. And that's it. Then we'll have to do a number of clinical studies for each of those areas I mentioned. And we'll have to move each of those forward. So let's take migraine, for example. We'll have to do a large migraine trial and hopefully have the data that says, you know what, this device could be used to diagnose a migraine, and then send that to the FDA and get that approved. So each area takes its own clinical trials, almost like its own company. Ultimately, in 5 years, I would hope that these would be on the fields of sports teams. We have a number of them that clinical trials that are going on right now. They're almost right on the field, or right in the back back of the bench of a hockey team, where a player gets hit and within a few minutes they can test that player and see. So I would love to be watching Monday Night Football, and someone gets hit and they take them in the tent and they're able to test them and tell immediately. Or it goes to my grandma and is able to test, once a week she takes the test, and to see if dementia is progressing, or in a police car. And so we hope that these devices can be everywhere. The way that we're making this work is all of those areas are in this one device, and kind of pick and choose which test to give. So ultimately, I would love to see these in doctor's offices, police cars, people's homes.
And I want to talk about your leadership style, because you definitely are a leader that creates an autonomous environment. You tell people what your expectations are, and you don't define any boundaries for them. You just let them go. And I think that is so amazing. So let's talk about your leadership style.
Nobody works for a company for 30 years anymore. You know, my grandfather worked for Ford Motor Company for 30 some years. And that just doesn't happen anymore. And so my leadership style is find out what the person wants in 10 years and try to give them those skills that they can then take to that next job. It's okay when people leave. Everybody can be replaced. And I remember saying that to everybody. Everybody can be replaced. But you don't want to replace people that are good. And if you treat them properly and you pay them well and you help build them for their next job, they'll stay around, or they'll go to a great job and you can be happy about that.
Yeah. And I think it's very important for a lot of leaders to understand that fostering an environment where your team members and employees feel comfortable to grow and understand that their leader is helping to push them to the next level, I think that's important, you know? And I don't know if a lot of leaders truly understand that, because yes, we can be selfish and we want to hold on to those good eggs, but the best thing to do is to foster an environment for them to be their best selves and push them on to the next thing. I remember when I first met you and I was like, hello, Dr. Fiorini. And you were like, do not call me.
Do not call me, yeah. No. Unless you're a student in my class.
Don't call you Dr. Fiorini.
Do not.
So I want to kind of take a few steps back here. You mentioned that you have a PhD, an MBA, as well as an MHA. Can you talk with us about how your MBA and MHA has impacted your career path overall?
So I loved the PhD, the science part of the PhD. Mm-hmm. When I started my MBA, I had almost defended my PhD, but I started my MBA before that, and it was so different. Mm-hmm. The tests were different, the classes were different. You know, the PhD, you spend the first couple of years in essentially medical school, going through all the different classes, and then you spend the next X number of years doing your research. And the MBA was very different. You take a class and you get a test that has multiple choice, and you know, your PhD, they just hand you a bunch of paper and you just start writing. Mm. And so the MBA definitely gave me the backbone of understanding how business works. So I could look at an income statement or a balance sheet and at least understand what should be there. And that's the extent that I go with it still. So I have an accountant that works for us and a CFO that works for us, and their job is to dig deep into it. My job is just to know, just to skim the surface. And that's what I think the MBA does. It lets you skim the surface of a lot of different things. It gives you, there are things that you'll learn in the MBA that may not really work in the real world. The MBA, the MHA are great programs. I would recommend them to anyone. When I started my first company, one of the things I was still, I believe, in my 20s, late 20s. And I remember the state of South Carolina had some grants. And they said, we love you, Ryan, but we can't give you this money. You're not 30 years old, you've never done this. We need someone who has done this. And that's how I found my mentor, my co-founder.
Okay.
That's how I found him. And even though I had the MBA and I had the PhD and I had all the credentials, I didn't have the history. And so you have to build that somehow. And I think that's really the important thing, is spending that time in the company, even if you have to spend an extra couple years with the company to get an MBA or an MHA, it's gonna give you that surface, you're gonna see other things. I think one thing that's really important for people, they want to succeed, is to dig into other things that are out of their comfort zone. So don't just do your job and go home. Dig into those other areas, because they can be really helpful when you end up at your next job. And I remember with the financials, you know, you taking the financials for our full office, which was a pretty substantial office. Mm-hmm. When you then moved to the surgical practice, a lot of those carried over. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know that that's where you would go. You didn't know that that's where you would go. But we knew that getting that information was not gonna hurt anything. And so I think that's the important thing, is if people are dig into those different areas. If something is interesting to you, dig into it and try to do more in the company. And so I recommend an MBA to everyone. I will say this though, having an MBA or an MHA does not make you a business leader. It does not automatically, you don't automatically check a box, and you don't automatically run a hospital because you have this MHA.
Yes.
It gives you the surface, but you then have to prove that you know that information and that you can work with that information and that you can lead people. And so they're great to do, but it's not a ticket to a CEO job.
I like when you said that having an MBA or an MHA does not guarantee you a job running a hospital, because experience sometimes takes precedence over your degrees. And I use sometimes very loosely. A lot of times, experience actually takes precedence over having degrees. So Agreed. Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah, I totally agree. Even a PhD, I think those degrees show that you're willing to put in the time, mm-hmm. and that you have learned at a basic level a lot of different things, mm-hmm. but it absolutely does not show that you have the experience, and you need to get that experience. And I think if you get those degrees early in your life, and you know, in your 20s or early 30s, you still may need to spend years. You know, that the state said, you know, we love what you're doing, but we need someone with experience. And I think that's really important to then also find that person that you can work with and that you can learn from. And but you're right, in companies, I think people need to, if you want to advance, you've got to try to pick up some of those things that you may want to use in the future. Mm-hmm. If you just want a 9-to-5 job and you want to turn off your phone at 5 o'clock and just do your job, I wouldn't recommend the MBA. It's not going to advance you. It absolutely helps, but you have to be driven to want to do those things.
What quote do you live by?
So this is actually a funny story. In high school, when I graduated high school, in our yearbook, everybody was able to put a quote. And I was, you know, 18 years old, and people would put quotes by Albert Einstein, and my quote, all it said was why? Question mark. And that was it. And I remember my parents at the time sort of being a little disappointed that I didn't come up with some big meaningful quote. But ironically, 20 years later, I think that why still comes out in what I do every day. So one of the things that I will always argue about is when I ask something, why something's being done, and someone says, well, because that's how it's done. And that doesn't always work for me. There's ways that you can make things more efficient, or you can make things better. So I think asking why, although in high school, in my yearbook, just having the word why in it, looks a little different than someone with, you know, a famous quote. I think that's the one I still live by. And I ask why about a lot of things. Some things drive people nuts, why I ask why about. But I want to know how things work. I want to understand it at least enough to see, is this the best way that something's working?
That is awesome. So you're a lifelong learner. That's what I take from that quote. You want to know why. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, thank you so much for spending this time with me today, Ryan. You dropped amazing gems. You gave us some wonderful stories, and I really appreciate the time that you've spent with us today. So tell the people where they can find you on social media.
So I am on Instagram at Ryan_Fiorini. Also, my company is at Blink_CNS. For central nervous system, and also on Facebook.
Thanks again. All right, y'all, that's all that I have for you today. Thank you so much for spending this time with me and Dr. Ryan Fiorini. Make sure you hit that subscribe button, also like this video, and leave us a comment. Ryan will be checking the comments on this video, and he will be responding to some of you, so make sure that you interact with him and this video, and I'll see y'all in the next video. Peace. You like how I put you on the spot there?
Yep.